Hello friends, in this video we'll be discussing about a very important device used in neonatal resuscitation, that is the self-inflating bag and mask. Okay, so this is also known as an AMBU bag. Okay, so this is a self-inflating bag. Why do you call it a self-inflating bag? Because you can see that this bag, when I squeeze it and once I release this, it gets inflated on its own without connecting any gas source to it. Okay, without connecting any compressed air source or gas source, it gets inflated on its own. So it's called a self-inflated bag. So let us see what are its parts. Okay, so this you can see is the self-inflating bag, which comes in varying capacities from 240 to 750 ml for children and neonates. So for neonates with weight less than 1500 grams, we usually use a bag with a capacity less than 350 ml. And for neonates weighing more than 1500 grams, we use bags with capacity more than 350 ml. All right. Now you can see that on the front end of the bag is a valve assembly. So this is a valve assembly and this is the patient outlet. Okay. So on this patient outlet, we attach this mask. You can see that this mask can be either round, or you know, an anatomical mask is also available, which has an indentation for the shape of the nose. All right. So we attach this mask here to this end of the bag. So see, we have attached this mask to the patient outlet. All right. And here we said is the valve assembly. Now, what is the function of this valve assembly? When we squeeze this bag, so what happens, this valve opens and the air goes to the neonate. And as soon as we release it, the expired air, this valve closes and the expired air will not come back to the bag. Okay, so that is the function of this valve assembly. Here there is another valve that is called the pop-off valve or the pressure release valve. So what happens, you know, if you are pressing too vigorously, what will happen? Excess of pressure can go to the neonate and cause pneumothorax. So to prevent that, what happens, the extra pressure gets released by this pop-off valve. It's just like the whistle in a pressure cooker. Okay, the extra pressure gets released, right? And here, you know, sometimes we can even attach a pressure manometer to see how much pressure we are delivering to the baby. So we know the pressure required to deliver breath to neonate. For the first breath, we need higher pressure. That is around 30 to 40 centimeters of water. And for subsequent breaths, we need half of this. That is 15 to 20 centimeters of water. Okay. So on the other end of this bag, you can see that there are two openings, all right? So you can see one is a narrower opening, which is there for attaching oxygen tubing. You may or may not attach it. And the wider opening is there, which is for attaching reservoir. Again, you may or may not attach it. It is optional, all right? So let us attach the oxygen tubing. So here we have attached the oxygen tubing to it. And we have also attached the reservoir here. So reservoir can be in the form of this bag-like thing, or it can come as a corrugated thick tube. Okay. Now the function of this reservoir is to increase the FiO2 or oxygen delivered to the baby. Okay. Because what happens is, you know, if you do not connect reservoir, when you squeeze the bag and you release it, some air gets sucked in from this rear end. But if this reservoir is there, the oxygen will get collected here and will come back. So this reservoir helps in increasing the oxygen delivered to the baby. Okay. But as we said, the connection of oxygen tubing and the reservoir both are optional and not mandatory. Now, if you're not connecting either the oxygen tubing or the reservoir, how much oxygen will be delivered to the baby? So you will deliver the room air, that is 21%. If you connect only the oxygen tubing but no reservoir, how much oxygen you can deliver to the baby? So however much you increase the flow of oxygen, you cannot deliver more than 40 to 60%. But if you are connecting both the oxygen tubing and the reservoir, you can deliver up to 100%. So 90 to 100% FiO2 can be delivered to the baby. Now recommendation regarding oxygen in the neonatal resuscitation, we all know that for term neonates, you need to start with room air. That is 21% oxygen, even when you are doing this bag and mask ventilation. But for preterm neonates, we can use blended oxygen air mixture and we can start with around 30% FiO2. Okay. And we move on to use 100% oxygen only when the baby goes on to require chest compressions or if the baby is not improving even despite your positive pressure ventilation, despite your effective positive pressure ventilation, the baby is not improving. All right. So this complete device, once again, is a self-inflating bag and a mask with a valve assembly with oxygen tubing and reservoir. Alright. Now, what are the indications of positive pressure ventilation in neonate? Okay. So, one is during neonatal resuscitation, we give positive pressure ventilation if the heart rate is less than 100 per minute, if the baby is having apnea or gasping. Now, another use of this bag and mask is when we are going to connect a neonate to a ventilator, we can, you know, do bag and mask and assess how much pressure the lungs of the baby are requiring to show a visible chest rise. And accordingly, we can decide upon the initial ventilator settings. Now, what is the contraindication for bag and mask ventilation? A very, very important contraindication and a must-know thing for you, that it is congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Now, what happens if you do bag and mask ventilation in congenital diaphragmatic hernia? Now, you see this mask covers both the mouth and nose of the baby. Alright? So, if you're doing bag and mask ventilation in congenital diaphragmatic hernia, the air will go both through the mouth and nose of the baby, both through the trachea and esophagus of the baby. The air that is going through trachea is fine. But the air that is going through esophagus can further distend the stomach and bowel loops, okay? And the lungs will not get space to expand. As you know, the bowel loops have herniated into the thorax. And there will be further mediastinal shift because the intestines are distending with air. So, bag and mask ventilation is absolutely contraindicated in congenital diaphragmatic hernia. So, if a baby with congenital diaphragmatic hernia is having respiratory distress, what do you do? So, in that case, if the respiratory distress is severe, okay, then we will do bag and tube ventilation. So, instead of mask, you can connect this endotracheal tube to this bag and you can do bag and tube ventilation in babies with congenital diaphragmatic hernia who are having severe respiratory distress. Alright? So, what is the rate at which you do bag and mask ventilation? We do it at the rate of 40 to 60 breaths per minute. So, newborn's normal respiratory rate is 40 to 60 breaths per minute and we do it at the same rate. But if you're doing chest compressions and bag and mask ventilation together, we do it in the ratio of 3:1. That means 3 chest compressions, then 1 breath. 3 chest compressions, 1 breath. This 3 chest compressions and 1 breath should finish in 2 seconds so that we deliver 90 chest compressions and 30 breaths in 1 minute. Okay? So that is again a must-know information for you. The ratio of chest compressions and bag and mask ventilation is 3:1. Alright? So, what is the most sensitive indicator of effective bag and mask ventilation in the baby? So, it is improvement in heart rate. So, baby's heart rate is going to improve if you are doing effective bag and mask ventilation. And of course, after that, the color of the baby is going to improve, the oxygen saturation will improve. Okay? So, if you are doing bag and mask ventilation, still the baby is not improving, the heart rate is not improving, then we need to take ventilation corrective steps. What do you mean by ventilation corrective steps? So you have to ensure that the mask that you're using is of appropriate size. What do you mean by the appropriate size of mask? So it means that the size of the mask should be such that it should cover the mouth as well as nose of the baby. It should cover both the mouth and nose of the baby, but it should not go beyond the chin. Otherwise, the pressure will get released from that and you will not be able to deliver positive pressure ventilation. And it should not impinge on the eyes of the baby because injury to eyes can occur. So, the mask should be of appropriate size. The seal between the mask and face should be tight. Okay, if it is loosely, if you are holding it, all the air can leak out and positive pressure will not get delivered. So, the seal between the mask and face should be tight. For that, you know, we have something known as EC clamp technique. So, you form a E and a C. So, suppose you are standing at the head end of the baby, okay, and holding the bag in your right hand and the mask in your left hand. You hold the mask like this, okay. So, the mask is there between the middle finger and the thumb and the index finger supports the baby's chin. So, this is forming a E as well as a C where the mask is there. So, this is called EC clamp technique. Okay. So, the seal should be tight and the head of the baby should be slightly extended and the mouth of the baby should be slightly open. Alright. So, these are the precautions that we need to follow and the ventilation corrective steps. So, very, very important device used in neonatal resuscitation, the self-inflating bag, the mask, the valve assembly, pop-up valve, the reservoir, the oxygen tubing used in neonatal resuscitation.